Just so that you know, gents, we don't have any attendees online as yet. My guys are just quickly swapping the session around on the platform. So I will see that the attendees start joining in, but I'm just going to mute myself again. I'm just letting you know. excuse me. We might just wait an extra an extra 5 minutes, but I will communicate with you in the text forum.
Welcome everybody. Sorry for the delay. We have some technical issues. Seem to be a recurring theme when the network specialist has to talk to the network or network related issues we're going to have. We're just going to give it a few minutes for those to try to log in again, and we should start in 3 minutes time. Thank you. welcome everybody again. This is our second attempt to the talk today. It seems like the Sunring talk is always cursed by some issues. 2 years ago, we had the lightning storm, and the year before, we had always international connection issues. So a bit late, but we are going. So it's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Matthias Mutumbuka, the Chief Executive Officer of Ubuntu Net Alliance, an international organization that has provided broadband and other technologies service for 26 countries all over Eastern and Southern Africa. As an accomplished academic, engineer, and speaker, Dr. Mutumbuka has over 10 years senior management experience in telecommunications, academia, oil, and in the banking industries. Before accepting his new role at the Ubuntu Net Alliance in May 2019, he worked for Airtel Africa, before that Mulswitch, and for Shell. Significantly, he also has a South African connection, being an adjunct lecturer in the management of technology at the Business School of UCT, Cape Town, South Africa. Professionally, Dr. Mutumbuka has served as the president of the Malawi Institute of Engineers. He currently sits on the board of several companies and organizations. Dr. Mutumbuka has received a PhD in engineering science at the University of Oxford in England in 2005, after graduating at the University of Malawi with a bachelor degree in science and electrical engineering, and is also a Rhodes Scholar. In 2012, he was among the 25 young Africans selected by the African Leadership Institute of Arts Bishop Tutu Fellow. He's a renowned motivational speaker, and for 10 years he has been writing two weekly motivation columns in the newspapers. This, I welcome Dr. Mutumbuka to present an integrated approach to enable digital transformation in the education sector. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Renee, for that introduction. And thank you for the privilege to be here to present at this very important conference. So I'm going to look at our integrated approach to enabling digital transformation of the education sector. And I'm going to speak for about 45 to 50 minutes. And then we're going to have about 10 minutes of question and answer, which Renee will eagerly host. So I want to start by saying, maybe you need to know a little bit about Ubuntu Net Alliance first. So we are a regional education and a networking company or organization for Southern and Eastern Africa. And we look at the countries that we operate in. There are actually 26 countries in this region. And primarily, our role is to provide internet connectivity to the national research and education networks. And we do this on non-profit basis. So we are not profit making. And that is why we're able to deliver these services at affordable rates, as you will see later on. And we do this by building networks across the region. And most of the times we use leased lines or what they're called IRUs so that they can be effective and we don't take time to go to the market. We are owned by our members. As we mentioned, we are not profit making. So the NRENs own us, and just as the universities and research centers own the NRENs. So it's a very good model, hierarchical model. Our secretariat or head office is in Lilongwe, Malawi, here in Malawi, and our engineering hub is in Kampala, Uganda. So we have a distributed setup of the offices. This is our background. We were formed 15 years ago. And I'm pleased to mention that South Africa was a key founding member of UbuntuNet. South Africa was there at the beginning, alongside with Rwanda, Mozambique, Kenya, and Malawi, as you can see there. We are registered as a trust in Malawi, where our head office is. And also, we are recognized as an international organization supported by the Ministry of Education in Malawi as our host. And through that, we get a lot of benefits and support from government organizations. What do we do? First of all, we represent our members at many, many levels, regionally as well as global levels. You can see in the picture there, we were signing alongside WACREN and ASREN. we're signing an agreement that I talk about AfriConnect 3 project in Brussels with the EU, who are funding us for expansion of our network and services. And then we also promote the establishment of new NRENs. You can see in the picture here, a year ago in December, I am with the lady there who is the Deputy Prime Minister of Mauritius, where we are holding 2-3 day workshops and meetings with ministries trying to set up an NRAN in Mauritius. And I'm pleased to mention that we have now quite advanced, and we should be setting up an NRAN in Mauritius in the next 4 to 6 months. So that's just one example. We're also working hard to establish an NRAN in Botswana, close up to South Africa there. We're working with professors in Eswatini or Swaziland to establish an NRAN there. And also we're looking at South Sudan. We are quite advanced there and a few other countries so that we move from 16 NRANs that we have to the full number of NRANs, which is 26. We have 26 countries in our region, but only 16 have NRANs. We still have 10 to go so that we can cover the whole of our region. And then we also do community coordination. You can see in the picture there, we have engineers from Terranet in Tanzania who went to Tenet in South Africa, supported partly by UbuNet Alliance, but most primarily hosted by Tenet, and we are grateful to South African NRAN for hosting these engineers and training them. When they went back to Tanzania, they were equipped, capacitated, and energized, and they wrote very impressive feedback. Similarly, last year in December, we had engineers from Mozambique, Zambia, and Uganda supporting Malawi to set up their network and NRAN in Malawi. So we can see the community, by working together, we're able to leverage our synergies and go far at affordable cost structure. But also we conduct a lot of capacity building. And here you can see NCRS, they were providing training to our engineers. And since 2014, more than 1,000 engineers have been trained, facilitated by UbuNet Alliance and our partners. We also build and operate the regional network, as I mentioned earlier on, and we look at the countries where we have our presence. And then you can see there that we also had the CEDA who helped us to connect universities in Rwanda, Tanzania, and Uganda because we lobby and raise awareness. And that's why CEDA came in. That's why the EU already, but also work with the World Bank. And recently we've got funding from the French International Development Agency who have given us 35,000 euros to do a country study, diagnostic study, which will inform how the French can help us at a significant level. So we're looking for that big opportunity, but also we're talking to other international partners so that beyond the EU, the World Bank, and the Swedish International Development Agency, we can have more supporters. And then here's our NRAN members. As I mentioned, there are 16. We have Burundi, DRC, Ethiopia, Madagascar, Kenya, Malawi, Mozambique, Uganda, Tanzania, Somalia, Rwanda, Zambia, South Africa, of course, Namibia, etc. And you can see in the map there, the colored part of the map is where we operate. And only the blue countries are the countries that we are yet to establish the NRANs, the 10 that I mentioned earlier on. But the ones in orange, we already have the NRANs. And here is pictorial view showing where we have the different point of presence across our region. And listed there are the NRANs that are connected to our backbone. Why do we need the NRANs? Because NRANs help the professors and researchers to share data, but also NRANs help research and education institutions to access connectivity services that are cheap and affordable because of our structure, we don't make profit. But also it enables ease access to digital resources that are available in other institutions globally because we are connected with other regional bodies in Europe, in Asia, and other regions of Africa and America, as well as Latin America. NRANs enable research institutions to work together at national level as well. They come together at national level and in collaboration within the countries and beyond. Now here, this is very important. Beyond connectivity, we are also into services. We support digital transformation of services. For example, in Zambia, the Zambian NRAN Zamren helped their member institutions, the universities and research institutions during the COVID-19 pandemic. by building the learning management systems using Moodle, but also other systems that supported the university during that tough period and continuing now. And it's for free now until later on when they may be able to go into now commercial arrangement. So this has been very vital during this pandemic. As you know, most universities closed, and the only way education could be supported was through online learning, online teaching, so that, you know, this can continue. And we'll talk about other areas, how they supported also. And then we support web conferencing tools, for example, in Somalia. And Somalia is a very interesting case. Although it's a young NREN, they were one of the first NRENs that when COVID came, they quickly moved to building the system for online learning. They installed and implemented Big Blue Button for universities. And then quickly, they found that the capacity was found wanting. And then because we are a community of NRENs, they shouted out and they got help from Kenya, the NRENs of Kenya and Uganda, but also us as Ubuntu also came in to support them to scale up capacity. And our big learning point there was that we as the NN community need to already and always have the online learning mode and designed in a way that can easily be scaled up in capacity. And I think now it's well known that going forward, universities and research institutions need to operate in more than one mode so that you can easily just increase one mode of learning when times demand. For example, in crisis, then you can go fully online. And I think most universities now are deciding to go the blended way where students will learn in a physical setup, at the same time some modules or some of the courses will be delivered on online, or some of the components of their learning will be delivered online, maybe exams, for example. At the same time, we do know that this is put everybody on a learning curve. For example, in Africa here, some of the challenges we've seen is that many students did not have the devices. Some have laptops, but don't have mobile, but also access to data bundles. We'll talk about what Kenya did about that, and also South Africa, NREN. But these are some of the challenges we know. And also some students go to rural areas. How do they access internet? It was interesting when I was talking to the Zamren CEO. Zambia was experimenting an idea that I think could be perfected in the future, where they were thinking of having big Wi-Fi at the district level, at maybe the community ground or stadium, and then the students could come there and with social distancing, masking, and then access the Wi-Fi that is provided by the NREN. I think now we are beginning to become very innovative. Kenya was able to reduce the price of data bundles. We'll look at that shortly. And in Zamren too, they had some support from the telcos. So COVID has taught us a lot to move from just being connectivity provider to the Emirates to accelerate the plans we already had for providing services over and above connectivity. And we did this one because there was actually immediate need to go online, and that means you need to provide services, but also survivability of the NREN community because revenues from connectivity dwindled. In some of the NRENs, bandwidth utilization went to as low as 10% of the usual utilization. And because of that, universities were negotiating, some of the universities negotiated to completely shut down connectivity. Some of them negotiated to pay less. And it means also the NRENs also were negotiating with us as Ubuntu Alliance, some terms on how when they can pay, whether to pay less. It's a very complicated situation, but it has taught us in hard times to be dynamic. And I think the lessons are there for us all to learn and forge forward. One of our flagship services is, which I think many of you are familiar with, EduRoam, which helps the researchers and academics to roam. For example, a professor from University of Pretoria, if they go to Uganda, then they can immediately use the Material Investor Wi-Fi using the credentials from University of Pretoria. It makes it very convenient for the academic dons, scholars, and researchers and professors. Even when they go beyond Africa, when they go to Europe, they are able to use the same Eduroam to access internet. The NRAs were experimenting doing this at some of the leading airports as well, and I think that will add even more value. Now, we recently conducted a study to see how Eduroam services is doing. And of course, we know that 7 out of the 13 NRAs that are connected, 7 have Eduroam, and want to, by next year, all the NRAs that are connected should have Eduroam. And going forward, our new strategy is that when an NRA is connecting to Ubuntu Net Alliance, immediately Eduroam should be part of the package. So we're going to connect NRAs not just in terms of bandwidth, but there'll be a minimum package of services that will provide from the day one. And Eduroam is one of the default products and services that we want to provide. You can see there that up to 234 institutions are offering Eduroam to their members. And leading the pack, we have South Africa, Zambia, Kenya, and Uganda, where Eduroam is very, very active. From this study, we've understood what were the key challenges, why some of the NRAs were not actively using Eduroam. And we now have a roadmap that is going to help us to help solve those problems, including training the people that support Eduroam in the respective NRAs, but also maybe raising awareness to the end users. So there's a whole package of action that we're going to take to ensure that Eduroam is actively used across our region. Now, we also have cloud services, and the Ubuntu Net Alliance is now actively building its own cloud services under the Africa Connect 3 project, and we'll talk more about that later. But we also have some of our key members who are actively using cloud services. For example, Kenneth in Kenya, Tenet in South Africa, Somaliland, Renew in Uganda, and Zamri in Zambia. These 5 NRAs are quite advanced on usage of cloud infrastructure. And we have been running workshops for the NRA engineers to learn how to set up cloud services. And this is again one way where we as Ubuntu Net Alliance add a lot of value by bringing together members of our community so they can share information with each other at zero cost. You can imagine these kind of programs, one would have to fly to a distant country to learn, or even if it's online, they would pay a huge sums of money. And this is one of the value that we see in being part of the community of NRAs. And then we also have high performance computing, not a lot, but a little bit. We have Kenneth, CHPC, of course, in South Africa, Zamrin in Zambia. And the case of Zambia, for example, we are talking to the CEO there, Stein, and because we are trying to shoot a video there to narrate the story of how high performance computing is adding value in Zambia. And this you will see soon, because we want to share with our leading partner, the European Union, who have been funding us a lot. And Stein Mkandare, the CEO of Zambian NRAN Zamrin, was talking about how the meteorological experts in Zambia are using HPC to be able to predict weather in Zambia, which is something that they're not able to do before. As you know, prediction of weather is something very complicated, and you need very high-powered computing power. And this is one great highlight of how HPC has been of great value within some of our member NRAs. Now I want to talk about Africa Connect 3. This is a project where we are collaborating with the EU, Giant, Wakren, and ASREN in Africa Connect 3. And we're doing this as one way where we have consolidated efforts. And I'll talk in detail of this project. There are 4 objectives later. But also, we're not just collaborating with the Wakren and the ASREN Giant in Africa Connect 3. We are also collaborating with Association of African Universities to support research and education in Africa. For example, during the COVID 19 pandemic. Wakrin, Astrin, and us at Ubuntu Alliance worked with the AAU to develop a concept note on how NRINs can help universities and research centers during COVID-19 pandemic and future crisis. And that concept note, we were able to share with development partners, and some of them are now discussing with us, for example, World Bank discussing with us, and also African Development Bank. ADB are very, very eager to look at how they can support AAU, Wakrin, Asin, and Ubuntu Alliance to build and expand more infrastructure. But more than that, to ride on Africa Connect 3 project, so that things like how do you develop curriculum for online learning? How do you teach the professors to learn how to teach online? Because this has been also one of the challenges that the professors themselves are used to teaching in physical classrooms. It's a learning curve for them as well. So ADB is coming in to support curriculum development, the awareness, but also even last mile connectivity in some of the areas. It is still at concept level, it is still at discussion level, but we can see very positive direction on this. Some of the other collaboration that we have, recently we signed an MOU with Red Clara. Red Clara is our equivalent in Latin America, and we want to collaborate with the Latin American regional REN because we have a lot of similarities, even in terms of the stages of development, but also challenges in terms of the cash flow or maybe economy and many others. So we're working together to share experiences, to share best practices, but also to bounce. You always need somebody can bounce off your ideas. We also have been working a lot with the NSCR to train engineers, I mentioned earlier on, and working with the development partners to support NRINs. EU is our biggest development partner, but also the World Bank have supported Zimbabwe, Malawi, Burundi, and now they're supporting Ethiopia in a very big way. And we think that we should be able to now connect to Ethiopia probably next year because of the big support we're seeing from the World Bank. We're now just working out the numbers that can help the World Bank contribute towards the Africa Connect 3, because for Africa Connect 3, you need the counterpart funding, which for many NRINs is a big challenge. And for Ethiopia, the World Bank has already committed to help them. Ethiopia's demand for capacity is quite big, on the order of 10 gigabits per second. And we cannot finance that from Africa Connect 3 project alone. And so we need other development partners to come in. And it's very encouraging that development partners are happy to work together to support the NRINs. And then we also work with the telcos, the examples of zero rating in some of the NRINs or countries where education sites were zero rated during COVID-19. But also a very interesting case of Kenya there, as you can see, Kenneth, you know, struck a 40% price reduction for data bundles for students. So the collaboration between NRIN members and the telcos has been quite productive during the COVID-19 pandemic. Now, the much touted Africa Connect 3 project that I was talking about in detail now, this builds on the success of the Africa Connect project, or you can call it Africa Connect 1 project, and then Africa Connect 2 project. The first Africa Connect project was, or the first phase was 2011 to 2015 for a period of 4 years, and the total sum was nearly 15 million euros. That should be euros, not pounds. And this helped to establish the Ubuntu network and also connected the first countries that were connected at the beginning. And then after that, there came the successor phase, which was Africa Connect 2 project, that ran from 2015 until November last year, to the tune of near 27 million euros. And this helped us to connect 5 new countries to the alliance: Zimbabwe, Malawi, Burundi, Somalia, and DRC. You can see big impact. 5 countries which never had connection with us, connected. And if I can give an example of Malawi, universities were paying on the order of $200 to $300 per MBBS. And with this financing, Marin has reduced that price to the end to the universities and research centers to $85 per MBBS, which means that they're now paying nearly one third of what they were paying to ISPs. So this is one of the big advantages that universities and research centers are paying less and yet for very reliable and fast internet, over and above the other services like EduRoam, the learning management system we talked about, and so forth. And then now we have the Africa Connect 3 project, which started in November last year for 4 years up to 2023. And this now is to the tune of nearly 38 million euros. And this is focusing on enhancing human capital development in Africa. And here are the I think the slide is not here. I wanted to talk about the objectives, but anyway, in short, the objectives of the Africa Connect 3 projects are one, connectivity, and this is in three parts. One, to connect new NRENs. Two, to upgrade capacity for NRENs where the capacity is not adequate. For example, Somalia, they only have about 500 megabits per second, and yet the demand there is much bigger than that. So we're going to help Somalia to upgrade capacity to bigger capacity, which may meet their demand. And then you also have the new NRENs that we need to connect. For example, Mauritius and Madagascar are not connected yet. We're going to use Africa Connect 3 project to connect them. And then there's, secondly, there's capacity building, the training that I was talking about. And then thirdly, the cloud services that I was talking about earlier on. We're going to use Africa Connect 3 project to build cloud services for our NRENs. And fourth, and not the least, it's the advocacy. We need the other development partners to know what we do, lobby them so that they can come to the fore, and more importantly, to lobby the regional bodies, African Union, SADC, COMESA, etc., so that governments can also come in to support the NRENs in what we do. In terms of the what we did during the COVID-19 to support the NRENs, first of all, we had discussions with NRENs over the bandwidth costs because, as I mentioned earlier, it was a challenge because most of the NRENs had their universities shut down and therefore they didn't have income. So we discussed on how we can support them in terms of the cash flow or payment mechanisms, or in some cases, maybe they scaled down their capacity for a short period of time. And then we also introduced webinars for the NRENs staff on digital migration, learning management systems, workshops led by Xamarin, but also there was another webinar on video conferencing workshop, which was led by Somarin, who have done a lot in this space. And also University of Makerere helped us to train a lot of our members, this was well attended, on the instructional design in e-learning. And then we also had NREN Cloud webinar, which was led by Uganda, and also a cyber training for campus engineers, which was led by the Internet Society. And then on our own side, we've also been negotiating with the telcos, as I mentioned earlier on, in terms of support during the COVID-19, like zero rating and or price reduction like happened in Kenya for the bundles for students. And then finally, in terms of challenges. So I've mentioned the positive side, the strides we've made, the achievements we have registered, but also, you know, you can't just succeed without some challenges along the way. Some of the challenges that we've met and continue to meet are lack of funding for NRENs to participate in Africa Connect 3 project, because the way the Africa Connect 3 project works is that the NREN that is benefiting needs to contribute 20%. So if connecting an NREN requires $100,000, then the NREN needs to contribute $20,000, and then $80,000 comes from the EU. This is to enable that, to ensure that the NRENs have commitment and that they take this project seriously. But a lot of NRAs are unable to raise this money because it's a challenge in terms of economy in Africa, as we know, but also governments are not always coming forth to support them. And that's why we want to lobby governments. That's why that's the fourth objective of Africa Connect 3 project in terms of advocacy. And then secondly, there is limited awareness on the existence and functions of NRAs. And that's why, again, we want to do advocacy so that governments know the importance of NRAs, that development partners know the importance of NRAs, but also the regional bodies, African Union, SADC, COMESA, and the Eastern Bloc, et cetera. So we're taking this as a major challenge. In fact, we even recently have done a resource mobilization strategy for Bonaid Alliance so that it can inform our lobbying, it can inform our promotion of what we do so that we can have more support and therefore become sustainable. Because right now we are over relying on the EU funding, which you never know, it may not be there forever. And then number three, we do have competition from the ISPs. In some markets, ISPs don't like losing their business to the NRAN, and therefore they fight back, they have tactics, they reduce price, but we always say that an NRAN is not an ISP. It's more than an ISP. And that's why I said integrated approach to supporting digital transformation of education sector. Because we're not just providing internet, we're not just providing connectivity, but we're also providing other services like learning management system, the edge room, and many others. And then we also notice market monopolies in some of the countries. And then this brings in a lot of problems. For example, for us to get lease lines or IROUs becomes a challenge because of these monopolies. And I'll not mention the countries, but we've had challenges in a couple of countries with this. And then the maintenance costs are not low. It can be quite high. And then we're working out the pricing models with our members, which can balance between being affordable, but also helping us to pay upstream for the maintenance and operation costs. And then lastly, as we know, COVID-19 has been a major challenge. And there was a time when we went for a number of months without much inflows of cash from member entities because the investors shut down. So in brief, this is what we've been doing. And I think that you can see overlap between us and what everybody in this community is doing. And at that point, I hand you over to Renee for any comments. I welcome comments and questions, and we can discuss. In this session, I'll be joined with the Tionge Banda in case we need some further details. He works with me, he's online here, but probably I'll be able to handle most of the questions. Over to you, Renee.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate that your talk, even with our technical difficulties. So our first question is, how does South Africa benefit from the Africa Connect program? Sorry. How does South Africa benefit from the program?
Sorry, come again. How does Africa benefit from the what?
How does South Africa benefit from the Africa Connect program?
Right. Let me pass this to Tionge. He's project manager of the Africa Connect 3 project. Rudy, do you mind allowing Tionge Banda to speak? Is he there? Is he still there? Oh no, he's not there. Tionge, are you there? Let's see if he's there. Not there, then I'll handle that. But yeah, Tionge is there. So Rudy, if you can allow Tionge to speak.
You can type the answer also.
You can type, okay. But in short, so let's look at the four objectives. Number one is the connectivity. In terms of connectivity, I think South Africa, we know you have excess capacity. So that one, I think South Africa cannot benefit really. On the services, I think there is a room because if you compare South Africa, you have some services there. But if you compare South Africa and Giant, for example, Giant have 60 services, a big buffet of services. And we've been talking with Giant. We had a workshop in Madagascar, looking through all their services in Europe. And then we shortlisted 16 that we think are relevant for Africa. And then we want to drive those services using the Africa Connect 3 financing and with support of Giant to roll out those services in our region here. So I think there, South Africa can benefit by working with us, through us with EU financing and Giant to roll out more services going forward. As we know, Duncan Greaves recently made a presentation at the UbuntuNet Connect conference, and he mentioned how going forward, NRN communities will only survive if they boost services. The third one is the capacity building. I think on capacity building, we know learning and development is a continuous process, and therefore, even South Africa can benefit from the capacity building plans that we have. For example, there will be a lot of training workshops alongside the UbuntuNet Connect conferences, and engineers from South Africa are very welcome to attend those capacity building workshops for free. And then thirdly, the lobbying and advocacy. As we know, we need to continuously preach what we do so that there can be more funding. I know in South Africa, the government of South Africa is supporting the NN community there a lot, but we should not take it for granted. We need to continuously communicate our value proposition. And riding on the Africa Connect 3 project, we can have holistic lobbying, holistic advocacy for the governments, in all the governments, but also at regional level. So I think these are ways in which that South Africa can benefit from Africa project. I see that Tiwange has added there, says South Africa has enough capacity on its own. Africa Connect 3 helps South Africa to connect to the rest of Africa's research and education directly and easily. So that's an additional benefit of Africa Connect 3 project.
Thank you. The next question is there a general appetite to extend EduRoam in general within UbuntuNet Alliance to cities so that we can have students have access it beyond their campuses?
Sorry, come again.
Is there appetite to extend EduRoam in the cities beyond the campuses?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think there is, because what we're seeing is, first of all, we see that students, when they go on holidays, they still need to access, especially now with the blended learning. With the blended learning, students will be doing certain things during term time in campus, but also they'll be doing certain things during holidays. And also, as I mentioned earlier on, we should be ready for crisis like the COVID-19 pandemic. This means, therefore, we should already have a lot of points of presence for access. The example of Zamrin in Zambia comes to mind, where I mentioned that Zambia was experimenting with an idea of having EduRoam in every district at their stadium, local stadium. So maybe like 30 or 60 stadia across Zambia, having big Wi-Fi and EduRoam there, so that the students at home can go to their local stadium to connect to their university and access the educational material there. So indeed, I think there is a big appetite, there's a big need, and for the long term, it's imperative that we have EduRoam services in the most populous cities and towns where there's a lot of students. There is a case in point in Somalia, very interesting, where the Somali NRN within Mogadishu, they have put the EduRoam in locations where there's a lot of students, so that students can access the cheaper connectivity when they're at home at night and weekends. And this is benefiting students because A, they are paying far less than they would pay to the mobile telcos for the bandwidth. It's benefiting the universities because they get a portion of the money that students pay, and the NN itself. So it's win-win for the student, the university, and the NN. So that, I think, is also another example of how EduRoam needs to expand beyond just the campuses.
Thank you. We have opened a mic for Dr. Happy Sitole, because he seems to be really interested in your talk. So please, Dr. Sitole, ask directly.
Okay, thank you, Ranier, and thank you so much, Doctor. I think the important thing and what I wanted us to look at is with the whole thing of the alliance, how can we start looking at some of these pain points around the continent? And specifically, I was looking at this Edurome. And after we have done a study in South Africa in terms of the connectivity coverage, and we found that once the students leave campuses, the connectivity when they are at home. So we basically geolocated students. We got the addresses for students and geolocated students and overlaid that with the connectivity coverage across the country. So you realize that especially when you are studying and even when the professors are at home, they have to work. Going from 8 to 5 on mobile data, it's not sustainable. And hence, we're looking at this option to say, what are the other ways that we can be able to expand the reach for the entrance beyond the campuses? I think that's very important. And maybe at some point, we need to be able to look at all those challenges that you highlighted, that obviously the regulatory issues are not homogeneous across the continent. And we need to look at those issues that will be able to open up that opportunity. I think one also that we also been looking at is, say with SANRAN in South Africa, the licensing, the type of licensing that one has, where you are not able to exploit some of the technologies that you could be able to exploit. And those are some of the things that I think that we might have to look at. But overall, thank you very much for a brief overview and really giving us what the Ubuntu Net Alliance is doing. I think there is quite a lot that myself and Leon and also with Duncan will follow up with you so that we can start looking at this issue. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Doctor. That's a very good remark. And I like that you're challenging us as Ubunet to take the leadership on that one. And I'll be asking Tiwonge to talk about what is happening in some of our members, especially Uganda, and I think even South Africa, in addressing, in beginning to address how students at home can still use the NN, you know, resources to access the internet. But you've mentioned that we need to, you know, list down all these challenges and have a roadmap, starting with the low-hanging fruits. How do we solve one by one going forward? Thank you, Doctor, for challenging us, and I think we will we'll take it up in our planning for 2021. Rudy, is Tiwonge able to speak so that he can give an example of Uganda? Yes, Tiwonge, over to you.
Yes, I can speak. Thank you very much. Just to add from what Dr. Ntumbuka has mentioned, some of the NRNs in the region have been working with commercial companies to try to figure out the best ways of delivering capacity to students at home. And one of the ways that they have been doing was to work with providers to whitelist some resources or some websites where students like. This has been done, I think, in Kenya, in Uganda, and in some other places. But in Uganda, they also actually went ahead to experiment having a separate APN delivered by the telecom company. So it's like the NRAN provides a bit of their connectivity to the telecom company, and then a separate APN is created and then delivered via the mobile company's network. This has been done again in Kenya and in Uganda. It has been exciting to see how this was unrolling, and just to see how we could use the same approach and to scale it across many countries. We are going to be having a webinar on the 15th of of this month, just to get more NYN engineers in the region to understand what is happening and see if they can scale it. But at the moment, it has been done, I think, in Kenya and in Uganda. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you all for listening to the excellent talk of Dr. Muntumbuka. We really appreciate your time, and we're looking forward to the growth of UbuntuNet through South and East Africa. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Rene and Rudy and everybody. Thank you very much for also the contributions and the challenging us to do more. Thank you.
Goodbye, everybody.
Thank you. Bye-bye.